following lecture was produced by Glorian Publishing, a nonprofit organization, and is one of hundreds of lectures freely available via download, podcasts, streaming radio, and transcription. These lectures range in topic and complexity in order to address the many needs of humanity. We invite you to browse our library of lectures, books, courses, and articles to find teachings that suit you. Through the support of donations, Glorian Publishing has published 40 books, hosts international retreats several times a year, offers free online courses, and many other valuable resources, available to anyone worldwide. All of this has been made possible by the financial support of listeners like you. Your donations make it possible for this free public service to reach thousands of people every day. To make a tax-deductible donation in any amount, even anonymously, visit GnosticTeachings.org. Now, with heartfelt wishes for the end of suffering for all creatures, we begin the lecture. May all beings be happy.
Das Rheingold. Scene 1. On the bed of the Rhine. In the beginning there is nature. The nature appears as a smooth and uninterrupted flowing motion. From nature's endless darkness emerges the mighty Rhine. The steady stream of the river is all-encompassing. The three Rhine daughters appear, Voglinde, Welgunde, and Flosshilde. They swim around playfully. Flosshilde is the most conscientious of the three. She reminds her sisters that their plight is to guard the Rheingold. The Nibelungs are a subterranean, hard-working people. The Nibelung, Albrecht, appears at the bottom of the Rhine. The sight of the Rhine daughters, who are swimming playfully around, spellbinds him. When they see Albrecht, they tease him intensely, and yet they pretend to be attracted by the dwarf. One sings more seductively than the other, but in the end, all three reject him. Finally, the Rhine daughters mock him and laugh at his pain and despair. The Nibelung does not belong in the Rhine. The slippery bottom makes him lose his footing, and the humidity makes him sneeze. Neither is he able to catch hold of the nymphs. Finally, Albrecht is enraged and frustrated, and he hunts the three Rhine maidens. He threatens to take one of them by force, if they will not surrender voluntarily. But he is not at home in the Rhine, and they easily evade him. Suddenly, the morning rays of the sun illuminate the Rheingold. The gold starts to spread a golden glimmer. The Rhine daughters swim joyously around the gold and bask in the light of its luster. Albrecht cannot understand what is so splendid about this gold. The Rhine maidens then tell him that a ring may be forged from the gold, and that the one that carries this ring may have unlimited power and wealth. But they add, "This will never happen, because only the one who forswears love will be able to take the gold and forge a ring with this gold." The Rhine daughters are completely certain that nobody will ever do this, and least of all, this love-hungry Albrecht. But they are wrong. Mad with despair and enraged after the Rhine daughter's mockery, Albrecht forswears and curses all love, and he steals the Rhine gold and flees before the shocked Rhine maidens can take any action. Now he reasons that even without love, he may forcibly satisfy his lust. He renounces love with a terrible oath, steals the gold, and disappears. The three Rhine daughters despair of their loss. Albrecht is now able to forge the Ring of Power.
The Ring of the Nibelungen is a very famous opera composed by Richard Wagner in the mid to late 19th century. This opera actually consists of four operas in one. So it is a tetralogy, or a story with four major parts. This first opera, which we just heard a synopsis of, is called Das Rheingold. And of course, the story, as you heard, is about the Rheingold. The Rhine is a river in Germany. And when Wagner was compiling all of the European mythology in order to construct his mythical vision, he placed the gold in the Rhine itself, in this famous river, to emphasize the Germanic roots of the myth. This story of the Rheingold is actually, you could call, a prologue or a preface. It's actually the introduction to the main story. Das Rheingold is the archaic past upon which the remaining three operas are built, are founded. So it's important for the audience who's taking in this tapestry of the Das Rheingold to understand the point of the opera and to understand the conflicts that are expressed in it. It's these conflicts related to Albrecht and the Rheingold and the gods that play out over the course of the remaining three operas. Of course, The Ring of the Nibelungen is a very famous opera. Famous mostly because of its psychological impact. When Wagner wrote and prepared this opera, he revolutionized drama, music, theater, all these aspects of creative endeavor related to these times, changed because of this opera. And people of the age in which he wrote it were strongly polarized, either for or against. And Wagner was on everyone's lips. In fact, it's related that Karl Marx complained about this. Marx said, "It's so tiresome that wherever you go, people always ask you what you think of Wagner." It's hard for us in this time to really understand that impact that the operas had, because so much of what we now are used to as common in our music and in our entertainment, in theater and movies, is actually based upon the revolution incited by Wagner. But that's not our point. That's not the intention of these lectures. What we propose to investigate is the actual meaning of these stories. The actual content. What inspired them? What are they actually communicating? I can tell you at the very beginning that as much as we try to investigate and express the mystical significance of this story and its elements, we will only be able to penetrate into a very superficial level. Partly, I can tell you with complete sincerity that it is due to my own shortcomings and the limitations of any of us who try to enter into the study of this type of material. And the reason is, this opera, the series of operas, is illuminating the path to become a complete human being. And that path is organized in levels. And each of us, dependent upon our own level, will comprehend this work in accordance to our level. This means that as you go deeper in your own psychological work, you can go deeper into the meanings of this opera. Samael Envior was amazed by this opera. And he stated that it is a great mystery how it is that Wagner was able to write this colossal work and illuminate very profound aspects of Kabbalah, of alchemy, of all the esoteric path. And yet he left no trace as to how he knew it. And the more you understand about Kabbalah and alchemy, the more you'll understand about this opera. Because it is a work of alchemy. It is a work of Kabbalah. To understand that, the very outset, it's good for us to realize that the European mythologies, which we call Nordic or Germanic, are very ancient. We have this impression or this idea in Western culture that Greek mythology is the oldest. But it isn't. It's one of them. But the Nordic mythology has ancient roots as well. And of course, the Nordic and the Greek come from the same essential source, which is Gnosis itself. And this is the purpose of our studies, and this is why we always emphasize the universal nature of mythology. And we try to illuminate each mythological story by relating it to other myths so that we can grasp the universality of the wisdom that each of us needs. In the heart of Nordic or Germanic mythology is a great tree. This is called the world tree, Yggdrasil. The name Yggdrasil actually means terrifying steed. And it's said to be the horse of Odin, the father of the gods. What we can understand from this is if it's a tree and it's a horse, it is actually a vehicle of life. It is the tree of life. And in Nordic mythology, we know that Yggdrasil supports existence itself. It supports the nine worlds, as you find in the Eddas, that ancient Bible of the Germans, and the Nordic races. Yggdrasil is roughly divided into three major sections. So if we were to draw a tree with its roots and then the branches at the top, but around the center of the tree we were to draw a circle, a ring floating at the center. The bottommost part where the roots are would obviously be the inferior worlds, the submerged worlds, which have different aspects. And that's why in the Nordic mythology we understand that these inferior worlds are divided into three. In Gnosis we know that these are the inferior aspect, the physical aspect, and the superior aspect. So in the center of our earth, we have the physical part. But we also have an inferior dimension there and a superior dimension there. The inferior dimension is obviously hell. It's Dante's Inferno, which he explained very well. But there's also a superior part in the center of the earth, related to heaven. And it's related to the heaven of this earth. And there are temples there, and angels, divinities which guide the evolution of this planet. So these three aspects, or three worlds, are related to the bottommost part of the tree. And these are the first three of the nine Nordic worlds. In the center part, that plane which hangs in the middle of the tree, we have three more worlds. And again, we have these aspects, inferior, physical, and superior. In this middle realm, we have what is commonly called Midgard. And this is the world of the humans. Midgard actually does not appear in this first opera. The opera Das Rheingold begins in the first scene in the submerged worlds, in the lower part of the tree. The upper section, obviously, would be heaven, which has three aspects. So you see here nine worlds suspended on a tree of life. This is obviously the same tree of life which appears in the book of Genesis. And as you know, Genesis has at its root this little phrase, gen, which is related to generate, which is creation, the beginning. Das Rheingold begins in the waters. The very first moments of the opera, this beautiful music is playing, the audience is imagining the beginnings of creation in nature. And that creation, of course, happens in the waters, the womb of the Divine Mother. And as the opera opens and the music's playing, we descend. This is Wagner's instruction. And the audience is imagining descending into the bottom of the River Rhine, which are these lower waters. So here we see in the very opening moments of Das Rheingold, two bodies of water, superior and inferior, or upper and lower. If you've studied Gnosis for some time, you will immediately see that this relates to, obviously, the River Nile, when the waters are separated, or the waters of creation, when the Spirit of God divides the waters. And these waters relate to Da'at, the tree of knowledge. So here we see two essential trees for us to understand and keep in mind, because they play significantly in this opera. The tree of life and the tree of knowledge. The tree of life is Kabbalah. This is a map of the psyche itself. And truly, the entire series of operas of the Ring of the Nibelungen is a explanation of our psychological situation. It is actually a history. But it is a history that is happening now. And it's a history that will repeat in the future. It's a story that's eternal and universal, which is precisely why it is considered Gnostic. Gnosis is a universal wisdom and relates to all people from all times, but according to their level. We as a humanity have our psychological level, which you can witness just by looking at the products of this culture, by looking at the way we all relate to one another, looking at the structures of our society. You can see the level of our culture, of our world. But the wisdom itself is eternal. The beauty of that symbol, eternal wisdom, is immediately also in the beginning of this opera by the three Rhine maidens. The Rhine maidens, of course, are nymphs or mermaids, feminine elemental forces which live in the waters of the Rhine. But these are in Nordic mythology, the Norns. They are three maidens who are responsible for the fate of everyone. Even the gods have no power over them. These three are simply past, present, and future. So the three Rhine maidens, these three elemental intelligences, are here in the waters, guarding the Rheingold, being feminine. They represent as well the creative power of the Divine Mother. The Divine Mother has a womb, a chaos, a great ocean, which is called Prakriti in Hinduism. And within that womb, creation is gestated and gives birth. And the gold is the source of that. But the student who's trying to understand the meaning of these operas should pay close attention to the fact that the opera begins in the water. And it begins with the responsibility of these three Rhine maidens who are there to guard the gold. Now, as you see in the first scene, Albrecht comes. And he is a troll or a gnome or a creature of the underworld who's driven by passion. And he wants the gold. The Rhine maidens, of course, tease him. And this is a symbol of our own ego, which wants to take power, which, because of its lust, its passion, its desire, wants to take from the Divine Mother, wants to steal this divine gold. And of course, these divine women don't think that's possible. They believe that no one is capable of stealing the gold. It's good for us to pause for a moment and consider carefully the nature of these three Rhine maidens. In Greek mythology, you've heard about the Fates, three women who have a similar appearance as the three in the Nordic mythology, these three Rhine maidens. In Greek mythology, they are displayed as being, one is a spinner, a spinster, who is spinning twine, rope. The middle one is measuring the length of that twine, and the third one cuts it at just the right moment. Here you see past, present, and future in the Greek myth. And this twine represents the life of the person, the life of an individual. So these three women, these three symbols, measure each person's existence. And what is that measurement done by but karma? Now you see in Rheingold, Das Rheingold, that these three Rhine maidens are operating under the command of their father, but he's not named because he has no name. And what's interesting is not even the gods can influence the Rhine maidens. They have power over the gods. And this demonstrates something very subtle for the Western mind. We have this unfortunate characteristic in our personality, in our upbringing, that we think that God is beyond the law. And this is one of the most beautiful things about this opera, is it demonstrates very explicitly that God is not beyond the law. Even God has to respect the law. Karma is eternal. Karma is the basis for existence. And even the gods are subject to karma. The moment when you step outside the boundary that karma manages is the moment you step out of the universe, out of manifestation altogether. Otherwise, karma is always there. This is a very deep symbol in Das Rheingold, these three Rhine maidens. So we know that Albrecht comes and wants the gold. First of all, he sees the Rhine maidens and he wants them. And the Rhine maidens tease him and make fun of him. What's subtle here and good to look at is that Alberich tries to seduce each of the Rhine maidens. And he fails each time. So this is a symbol of how our own egotistical mind believes that it can outwit karma. And it can outwit the progression of our own development, past, present, and future. We think we're more intelligent or more clever than the law itself. And we're driven by lust. Lust, in its base, is a craving for sensation, for a feeling of self. And as you know, as we've discussed in these lectures many times, the idea of self, the sensation of self, is false. In the ultimate sense, there is no self-nature. Self-nature is relative to our level. And this is also beautifully represented throughout this opera, which we'll discover as we proceed through the story. But Alberich, of course, driven by desire, thinks he can outsmart these fates, the Rhine maidens. And of course, he fails. But in his failure, rather than recognizing his own idiocy, he becomes enraged against the Rhine maidens. And when he hears that the gold can confer power, he wants it. Now, in the stage directions for this opera, Wagner was very specific about how this scene should be represented on stage. And there's a reason. He said that, of course, the Rhine maidens are floating in the waters of the Rhine. But the stage should be organized in such a way that the bottom is the bottom of the river. And there's a great prominent rock which shoots up from the base of the river. And it's like a tower. And at the very top of this tower is the gold. Now, what else could this symbolize but a phallus? What else is submerged in the waters of the Divine Mother in order to begin creation but the phallus of the Divine Father? This is the beautiful and subtle symbol present in Wagner's stage direction that submerged in the waters of existence, penetrating the womb of the Divine Mother, is that phallic force of the Father who commands the Rhine maidens to protect the gold and to keep it safe. That gold is naturally spiritual. That gold is the source of power for all creatures. And that's why the Divine Father has commanded it to be protected and held safe here in the waters of creation, the waters of Genesis. Now, also in the stage direction, in this moment where the conflict is unfolding between the Rhine maidens and Alberich, Wagner says a ray of light penetrates into the depths and the gold is illuminated. And the Rhine maidens are so overwhelmed with the beauty of this moment that they forget Alberich. And the reason is the sun is the Christ. The sun is the solar logos, the universal cosmic Christ, who's present in all religions. And he is, of course, the God of light. And as this light illuminates the gold, the Rhine maidens begin to sing in ecstasy, an ecstasy of the soul, because of that beauty of the light illuminating the gold in the water. And Alberich, too, sees it and becomes inflamed with desire to have it, to steal the gold. And, of course, he does. But he has to do this in a very particular way. He rushes up the rock, and at the point of stealing the gold, he renounces love. He renounces the consciousness. He renounces his own inner divinity. Because, of course, God is love. Christ is love. And when we renounce that within ourselves, as a psyche, as a soul, we become like Albrecht, a toad, an abysmal creature, consumed with desire, lost in the underworld, in the darkness, consumed with the greed and lust for power and sensation. Now, Albrecht steals the gold and makes a proclamation that he renounces love and will have the gold in order to have his satisfaction. And from this gold, he plans to forge a ring upon which the entire opera is based. So now we will listen to the next section of the opera and see what happens next.
Scene 2, an open space on a mountain summit. Fricka, the goddess of marriage, and Wotan's wife, wakes Wotan, Odin, the chief of the gods, who dreams of power and honor. He had hired two giants, Fasolt and Fafnir, to build him and the other gods a mighty fortress, Valhall. It was completed while Wotan slept. He now praises the new fortress. Following the cunning Loge's advice, he promised the giants, the goddess Freya, Fricka's beautiful younger sister, as payment. Freya is the goddess of love and youth. In Freya's garden, apples grow, apples that secure the god's eternal youth. Fricka is very worried about her sister and accuses Wotan of lust for power and wanting to build the new fortress. At this point, Freya rushes desperately into the scene, pursued by the giants Fasolt and Fafnir. The giants request their wages as agreed. They want to take Freya to their home. Now Wotan is in a terrible situation. Freya was actually part of the deal with the giants, an agreement that is protected by Wotan's rune spear. But of course, Wotan does not intend to let the giants take Freya away. He explains that the agreement was only for jest. The giants must propose another pay. The giants keep to the promise, though, and they point out that Wotan rules through the power of his treaties, and that he, therefore, must keep these himself. Freya's brothers, Donner and Fro, will save her by force, but this Wotan prevents. Wotan expects Loge to soon appear and save him from this pinch. Loge is the roaming and changeable demigod of fire, and Wotan's smart advisor. Loge is the only character in the ring that appears both as a person and as an element. Just then, Loge appears in a flickering flame. Loge has two different missions. First, to check Valhall for faults. The intention of Wotan was that such faults would give the gods a reason not to pay the agreed for wages, Freya. Loge's report is short and is quickly delivered. Valhall is flawless. Loge's second mission was to try and find something to replace Freya as payment, something the giants would be satisfied with. This has not been very easy. Loge has traveled around the world. Everywhere a woman's love is appreciated above all. However, he does report of one exception. Loge tells the story of Albrecht. How Albrecht has renounced love, stolen the Rhine gold, and forged a ring of power. The giants also hear the story and decide that they may take the gold of the Nibelung as a substitute for Freya, if Wotan can supply it to them. Loge reports that the Rhine daughters want their gold back. Wotan too wants the ring and the gold for himself. His opinion is that this would secure eternal power and safety. As Wotan hesitates, the giants take Freya away and demand their payment be delivered before sunset. The gods suddenly feel weak. Loge knows that this is because Freya normally gives them golden apples, which bestow eternal youth upon them. Loge suggests that Wotan should take the ring from Albrecht, since it does not belong to him, steal from the thief. Left with little choice, Wotan agrees to try to win Albrecht's treasure. He tells Loge to lead him to Nibelheim, but not through the River Rhine. Wotan and Loge leave for Nibelheim. There they will try to steal Albrecht's gold so that the gods may release Freya and get their lost youth back. On their way down to Nibelheim, the sounds of lots of hammering dwarves is heard.
So in part two, the story becomes a little more complicated. Another aspect of the Nordic mythology, which is important for especially Westerners to understand, is that God is not seen as a bearded old man on a throne by himself. Like most other world religions and world traditions, God is a multiplicity. God is diversity. And in that diversity is the unity. Of course, in Gnosis, we study the army of the word, the army of the voice. And this is a way of understanding that both the monotheistic view of religion as God being one and the polytheistic view of God being many are actually one and the same. A way to look at that would be that a tree, we call a tree, actually in itself does not exist. A tree is a compound of parts, leaves and branches and all the different chemicals and elements that make up a tree, the structure. But God is the same. God as an entity, as a singular force, is made up of many parts. And this is why the Bible describes the body of Christ is the church. Because the body itself is made up of many parts, like our own physical body. And so is Christ. Christ is an energy. Christ is a force. And God is that. In Gnosis, we describe the Trinity, which is this first triangle on the top of the Kabbalah, the Tree of Life. And this Trinity is a three in one. It's a tri-unity. It's actually one force or one energy, which is Christ itself. But that force expresses in different ways depending on the need, depending on the circumstance, in the same way that your body will work in different ways, but it is the same body. You use your hand when you need your hand. You use your foot when you need your foot. But it's still you. It's still that physical body doing it. God's the same. Wotan, or Odin, is the first sphere on the Tree of Life. What in Hebrew is called Keter. And in Christianity, we call him the Father. And he, of course, is related to Jupiter or Zeus, the father of all the gods. Wotan has a very rich mythological and symbolic background. And in the story of the Ring of the Nibelungen, he's one of our central characters. And he is, of course, God. But he is God in his level. He is God as Keter, as the crown, as the father, who's responsible for guiding the development of all of those who are in his domain. Now, his domain, of course, would be the Tree of Life itself, all of the spheres which rest below Keter. And he manages them with the assistance, with the help of his many parts, which are the other gods. This is why sometimes when we read mythologies, we become confused that one god is married to multiple wives, or one goddess has multiple husbands. And this is symbolic of the integrated nature of God and can be understood best through meditation. The story opens with, or scene two opens with Wotan and his wife Fricka. Fricka, of course, is his feminine aspect. Wotan is dreaming. He's asleep. As you know, when you study Hinduism, we also hear about the gods who sleep and dream. But when Fricka awakens him, she says, "You should come and see the fortress that's been built for you by the giants." And this fortress is called Valhalla, or we call it Valhalla. And that name means simply the house of the warrior, or the warriors. Wotan hired the giants to build it for him, as a place for him to consolidate his efforts to maintain safety and security for everyone who's in his domain. Valhalla, then, this hall of the warrior, is the tree of life itself, the lower aspects from him. It's in the Bible called the celestial Jerusalem. It's the soul. It is the structure which God needs in order for his cause to be advanced. And his cause, of course, is self-knowledge, to know oneself, in order for the God himself to advance in his own objective reasoning. Now, Wotan has one eye. He wears a patch over his eye. One of his eyes is gone. In this opera, Wagner explains this through a dialogue between Fricka and Wotan. Fricka is concerned that Wotan wanders too much. He's known as the wanderer. And she is the goddess of fidelity and marriage. So she wants to be nested in a safe home. But Wotan always wants to be out, the hunter, the wanderer. So she was supporting the idea of building Valhalla as an idea, a way of keeping her husband home. So you see a beautiful conflict, a beautiful give and take between Wotan and Fricka, which relates well to man and woman. And what resolves this between them is the arrival of Freya. In the opera, they sing it as Freya. Freya is Fricka's sister. And of course, Freya is the goddess of love. So this conflict, or this push-pull, plus and minus, between the Divine Father and Divine Mother is equilibrated with the force of love. So right here you see a beautiful symbol of the three forces, which are required for any form of creation. Wotan being that positive, projective, masculine energy, Fricka being the receptive, passive, feminine energy, and Freya is the force that causes them to bind, to unify, and to create. Now, Freya is the goddess of love, of harmony, of balance, Fricka's sister. Freya's job in the mythology is that she's the one who provides strength to the gods. She provides them with their vitality. And how does she do that? With golden apples. Now, there's something very interesting here. If we remember in the first scene, we have those three Rhine maidens protecting the gold in the waters. Part of the job of those Rhine maidens, which is not in the opera, but it's in the mythology, is that they feed the tree of life itself. They feed Yggdrasil. So in the very bottom of the tree of life, we have the inferior worlds down here, the lower worlds. And at the root, we have, of course, the three aspects of those inferior worlds. And in the middle part, we have three aspects. And in the upper part, we have three aspects. But in each one, each of those three, in the ancient mythologies, in the Eddas, it says that there is a well. There is a well of water in each realm. A spring, in other words. And this is the water that sustains the tree. But the main one, the one that keeps the tree alive and healthy, is related to these three Rhine maidens, and this is in the upper part, or in the heavens. Without the water from the Rhine maidens, the water that has the gold in it, the tree will fall apart. It will die. And that tree is the universe. That tree is our own soul. It is our own psyche. Freya represents another level of that, another aspect of that. And she is the goddess, related to waters, who takes the apples of gold to feed the gods and to sustain their power. Of course, this has a direct relationship with the Greek mythology. You find the goddess there who has the same exact responsibility. And you also find it in the Hindu mythology related to Amrita, that divine elixir which keeps the gods sustained and alive. This is ambrosia. So all these world traditions have a goddess who delivers a magical or vital substance which keeps the gods alive. But what does Wotan do? To have his castle, he has to hire the giants to build it, and he has to pay them. Now, this deal, this contract, is actually the brainchild of another god. And he is perhaps the most paradoxical, the most mischievous, the most diabolic, and perhaps the most honorable one. And this is Loge, also known as Loki, Mephistopheles, and Lucifer. He's the trickster. He's the deceiver, but he's the god of fire. So be aware of these symbols. The waters, which feed the tree, the gold in the waters, and the god of fire. Important. Loge is a universal symbol, present in all religions. In the Greek myths, he's called Prometheus, the one who gives fire to man. In the Bible, he's called Lucifer, the bearer of light, the bearer of fire. But, unfortunately, he has some problems. Loge is the advisor of Wotan. And Loge is everywhere and involved in everything. And you'll see that as we go through the story, that Loge is always right in the middle of every problem and seems to be the cause of the problem in many cases. So in this case, for example, we have this deal to build the castle, to build Valhalla. That construction is performed by giants. Now, we understand that the term giant refers to someone of a big stature who has a lot of power, a lot of force, a lot of strength. And when you reflect again on the Greek mythology, you probably remember that it was the Cyclops who built the domain of the gods in the Greek myths. So likewise, in the Nordic myths, we have the giants who build the domain of the gods. But who are these giants? These giants in the opera are presented as two brothers or two companions. Get their names. Fasolt and Fafner. They arrive to receive their payment. Of course, as they are coming, Fricka is reminding Wotan that he promised to pay them with Freya, to give them the goddess of love as payment. To understand this, we have to grasp what this symbolizes. Remember that this opera concerns past, present, and future related to the Rhine Maidens. The construction of the castle, of the fort, the domain of God, is the construction of the Temple of Solomon within us. It's the construction of the soul. But that process is a matter of great efforts which proceed according to cosmic evolution. What's symbolized here in these two giants is very deep. Like many things in this opera, there are levels to this. But in the immediate level, we can analyze that these two giants represent two previous races, the Lemurians and the Atlanteans, who were giants in the sense that they had a more elevated spiritual understanding than we do. They weren't as degenerated as we are. And the story explains this, the opera does. And this symbolizes how, through the course of the development of the cosmic realms, the development of this humanity through root races has unfolded. And the structure of the soul has developed further and further in order to advance the understanding of God, to advance his own self-knowledge. Now, another beautiful aspect of this is the eye of Wotan. It's not in the opera, but in the myth, you find that when Wotan realized he needed more knowledge, he needed more understanding, he plucked out his eye and he put it in the well of the Rhine Maidens as payment, as an offering, as a sacrifice. That, in other words, he put his own way of seeing, his own way of vision, his own way of perception into the waters. He made that sacrifice so he could know himself. And what else is a way of seeing but a part of consciousness? The essence, the soul that we have now. Wotan plucks this part of himself with pain and puts it deep into the waters. And it's that part, the essence, which grows and elaborates through the process of alchemy in order to return to Wotan, our own father. This is the nature of the path. In the opera, it says that he did this in order to gain his wife. And it's the same thing. He sacrifices his eye in order to gain more complete development of himself, to acquire his feminine aspect, who is the waters, the Divine Mother. Yet another aspect there, if you look at the tarot, the first card is the Magician, which is Keter, this first sphere on the Tree of Life. And at the top of that card, you will recall there are a pair of eyes. And when Master Samael Anvior explains the symbolism of this card, he says that these eyes represent the symbol of infinity. So if keter, wotan, is to sacrifice an eye, this is how he himself enters into manifestation between the Maha Pralaya and the Maha Manvantara, the great day and the great night. In other words, he leaves the absolute, that bliss of perfect existence, in order to enter into manifestation, which is imperfect. So this is pain. For the gods, this is pain, to enter into manifestation, for the ones that can reside in the great pralaya, in that night of bliss. So as I said, there are many symbols related to each element of this story. Nonetheless, Fricka arrives. And of course, she's very concerned because she's about to be given to the giants. Fricka and Wotan then have a little bit of a conflict. And Freya, of course, is the object of this conflict. Fricka, the wife of Wotan, wants Freya to be saved, to be kept with the gods in order for them to keep their power. Because if Freya is delivered to the giants, the gods will lose their vitality. In this conversation, Fricka accuses Wotan and says, I wanted you to build this castle so that you would stay home with me. But instead, I can see that you're going to use this as a base for you to conduct your conquests and to be out. And that's why you want to give away my sister. Wotan says, nothing can keep him at home. Because he needs constant change in order to live. This is a great psychological lesson for a Gnostic student. God is not static, stagnant, or still. God is in constant movement, constant motion. And this is the symbol. And as a Gnostic student, as a student of the spiritual path, we have to grasp that in our own work. We should be seeking constant change as a psyche, as a mind. Because that's what our own God needs. He needs for us to change so that his own development can advance, so that we can return to him. So Freya enters into the scene pursued by the giants, and the giants want their wages. Of course, the giants tell Wotan, you made a deal with us and you have to keep it. But the deal was the brainchild of Loge, the trickster. And Wotan never had any intention of fulfilling the deal, of giving them Freya. Because he expected, based on Loge's words, that there would be some imperfection in the castle, there would be some issue which would allow him to keep his sister-in-law, the goddess. Now, at this point, two new characters enter in order to interject and try to prevent the goddess of love being taken away. And these two characters are, in the opera, they're called Donner and Fro. Donner wields an axe, a hammer. It's a two-headed instrument. And this is a symbol of willpower. It's the shape of a cross. These two gods intervene and try to block the giants. And these two symbolically represent the other two aspects of that solar logos. If we have Wotan as the father, then we have Fro as the Christ, as Chokmah, the son. And we have Donner as the Holy Spirit. Donner wields the axe, or the hammer, which is the shape of a cross. And Fro is the sun, Chokmah. The reason, the symbol of that becomes clear at the end of this act, or the end of the this opera. Now, in this conflict that's arising between the giants and the gods, Wotan is stalling, and he's waiting for Loge to save him and give him the answer to this quandary. How do I get out of this deal that I made? And Loge arrives as fire. So the answer to the conflict is in that fire, is Lucifer. But the answer is not what you might think. Now, of course, we understand that Loge was coming back from his mission to check the castle and finds that it's perfect. And the second was to try and find something to replace Freya, to pay the giants with. Now, the giants, as I mentioned, are symbolic of these previous races through which our own psyche gradually evolved to become a little more sophisticated, to become this castle, which the gods can then inhabit and use. So this story, in this moment, represents a period within our own evolutionary history, which represents a time related to Lemurians and Atlanteans. And this same period of time is represented in the book of Genesis with Cain and Abel. And of course, these two giants are Cain and Abel. Loge tells the story of Albrecht. And Albrecht renounced love, stole the gold, and has forged a ring. So Loge tells Wotan, if we get that, the gold and the ring, we can pay the giants. The giants, of course, hear this idea, and they want it. But they decide to take Freya as a hostage, and when they do that, the gods become weak. What's good to reflect on here is that at all levels of the tree of life, there is a certain amount of give and take, push and pull, conflict. We have this sort of kindergarten concept that when we enter into the heavens, everything is blissful and beautiful and perfect for eternity. That is not the case. And that's why in the Nordic mythologies and the Greek mythologies and the Hindu mythologies, the Buddhist mythologies, we always hear stories of wars among the gods, of deals made and broken, of problems. Why? Karma. Even the gods are subject to it. So, as we advance into the next scene, we'll find out a little bit more about how that is.
Scene 3, in Nibelheim. Albrecht has forced his brother Mime to forge a magic helmet called the Tarnhelm.
Mime.
The one who carries the Tarnhelm and knows the magic words can make himself invisible or transform himself into another being. Mime tries to keep Tarnhelm for himself, but Albrecht brutally takes hold of the helmet. The now invisible Albrecht terrorizes Mime and the other Nibelungs. Albrecht leaves just as Loge and Wotan arrive. They listen to Mime's complaints of Albrecht's violence. Loge promises Mime that they will free all Nibelung dwarves from Albrecht's tyranny. Albrecht arrives and becomes visible. He recognizes Wotan and Loge immediately and asks them why they are there. He is told that the gods have heard of his new might and wanted to see if the rumors were true. Albrecht considers himself to be the future ruler of the world, and he predicts his own rule over Wotan and the gods. Wotan is provoked and moves to strike down Albrecht with his spear. Loge manages to calm Wotan down. With flattery and hypocrisy, Loge tricks Albrecht into demonstrating the magic power of Tarnhelm. Loge asks Albrecht to demonstrate something very frightening. Albrecht transforms himself into a giant dragon. Loge and Wotan feign fear. They then ask Albrecht if he could transform himself into something tiny in order to evade his enemies. Albrecht doesn't see the trick and turns into a toad. Loge tells Wotan to catch the toad, the gods seize the Tarnhelm and leave Nibelheim with Albrecht as their captive.
This short act or scene concerns us very directly. Albrecht, of course, as I mentioned, is representative of part of our own psyche. This part of our psyche is portrayed in the book of Genesis in the Bible, in the story of Adam and Eve, when the serpent shows to Adam and Eve the tree of knowledge and asks Eve about it. And Eve says, God said we should not eat of this tree. And the serpent says, God said that because he knows that if you eat of it, you'll become as gods, knowing good and bad. The serpent does not say, eat it. The serpent doesn't tell Eve to eat the fruit. Neither does he offer it. He just asks what it is. Why is it like that? And Eve is tempted by her own desire. This is a very, very important part of the book of Genesis that has been misinterpreted for centuries. And everyone blames Eve and the serpent. But it should be grasped that the serpent is playing a role there, which is very important. That's why Master Jesus says, be ye wise as serpents and harmless as doves. Because the serpent has a kind of wisdom that we need, a subtlety of understanding. Well, in this story, Loge is that same serpent, who's a little tricky. He works with a kind of subtlety of thought, a subtlety of intelligence that we are very easily fooled by. Albrecht, of course, is our own desire. It's this part of our mind which, in the course of development, becomes entranced or enslaved with passion, with lust, with craving for sensation. And that craving, symbolized in the opera, is represented in Albrecht stealing the gold. The gold is the same as the golden apples. It's a magical force, a magical energy, which rests inside the waters. And those waters are sexual. When Albrecht steals the gold, he's stealing the energy of God. He's stealing the vitality, the force, which can sustain the gods. But this is happening on different levels. You see this, right? Albrecht is stealing the gold from the base of the waters. But the giants are acquiring the gold through their labors. And so what's happening with God? What's happening with Wotan and all his parts? He's losing power. There's danger. There's a problem. So you see here, God is not above the law. God is not existing there eternally without issues, without problems, without challenges. When Wotan and Loge come into the inferior worlds and they find Albrecht, Albrecht has, of course, made the ring, and he's also commanded his own people to serve him. He's become a tyrannical ruler of the Nibelung, which is a race of creatures deep down in the earth. And he's commanded his brother, Mime, to fashion a magical helmet which confers powers on Albrecht. And of course, how is this made? How is this all happening? because of the gold that he stole. The symbol here is that our own egotistical psyche, when it's infected with desire and power, takes the otherwise pure gold and fashions it into its own creations. It fashions that energy, that force, into something that has a lot of strength, a lot of power, but perverse. Where do we see an example of this now? In a very superficial way, we can see how now in these times, humanity is taking all the beautiful capacities that we have as a mind and as a heart in order to create machines of destruction, to kill each other, or in order to create economic or political systems to enslave other people, or to create gossip and slander and psychological or social traps in order to hurt other people. These are ways in which we take the energies that we receive from God and we corrupt them and use them in the wrong way. But in specific focus, in relation to this myth and other myths like it, the gold in this case is fashioned by Alberich and his brother into the Tarnhelm and the Ring of Power. How? Through fornication. The waters contain the gold, the sexual waters, the waters of Genesis. But when that water and those sexual forces are infected or impure or made impure with lust or desire, those waters are turned black. They're putrid. But yet, because they have that creative power of God, they can create. But they create the ego. They create more desire, more lust, more anger, more suffering. And yet, the creations of the ego seem to be fantastic. For example, our own sense of self, which is false, is a creation of the ego in its root, because it has no true basis for existence. This is why Buddhism says there is no self. Because the self nature that we walk around with every day truly does not exist. But we think it does. And because we continue trying to feed that and elaborate that self-image, putting on different clothes, putting on different beliefs or different theories, or adjusting ourselves this way and that way to fit into the flow of life, we keep trying to believe that this sense of self is real. But it isn't. It's a deception. It is an illusion. And that is the Tarnhelm. The Tarnhelm is a magical helmet which gives its wearer powers to be invisible, powers to change shape, to become different things. This is the power that the ego has when it's trapped the consciousness inside. The source of that energy is God, is the gold, which is that sexual force. But when the ego traps it, when Albrecht takes it, he utilizes that force for his own pride, for his own lust, for his own cravings, his own envy, his jealousy, his anger, his resentment. And he forms from that this ability to change his shape, to look like different things. We do that because we are very insincere. We try to make ourselves look like the way we think others want us to appear, rather than being who we are. If someone wants us to, let's say we want to get a job in a particular place, then we get this idea, a concept, that we have to look a certain way in order to fit into that job. So we change our appearance. Or if we want to be friends with someone, some particular person, then we alter our appearance in order to be the way we think they want us to be. We do this with our spouse. We do this with our parents, with our friends. But the most destructive, damaging, and persistent way we do it is with ourselves. We project an image to our own selves, which is false. We like to tell ourselves that we are a certain way. We have certain virtues or certain attributes that we think we have. And we tell ourselves that we have that. And we persistently encourage this deceptive illusion. So we lie to ourselves. Not only lying to others, but to ourselves. Of course, Albrecht is very satisfied with the Tarnhelm and the ring. The ring, it said, gives him power over the earth. Power to command all things. And in truth, it does. But again, the power comes from the gold. In other words, we can say, God gives us strength, but our ego steals it. And our ego creates suffering, which is what Albrecht does. He takes the powers of the ring and begins to put himself up as a tyrannical ruler, as a big shot, as if he's somebody. Now, of course, Wotan sees the threat that the ego represents. The ego now has the power of the gods. And Wotan is about to strike him down in order to finish with that threat. But who steps in but Loge? This is a very interesting moment. Because in this moment, God could have simply killed him, and that'd be the end of the story. Why does Loge interfere? It's very curious. How is it that Loge knows more than Wotan? How is it that Loge is able to very cleverly manipulate Albrecht where God is not? Well, Wotan, or our own inner father, cannot mix with the ego. They're like oil and water. But Loge is the mixture of the two. Loge is the bearer of fire who's trapped inside the gold. This is never stated explicitly in the opera. But watch through the course of the story how everything that happens with the gold is related to Loge. He's very much concerned. Even though he doesn't need it, he doesn't want it. But he's very concerned with what happens. Why? He interferes here and he taunts Albrecht and says, oh, well, you must really be a big shot now. Show us your power. Show us what you can do. So, of course, Albrecht makes himself into a great dragon. We do the same thing. When we become inebriated with our own self-satisfaction, our own inner Loge taunts us. The moment we acquire a little bit of power, a little bit of money, a little bit of force, we use that to lord it over those around us. Or worse, to build up our own self-image into something false. We make ourselves into a dragon. A dragon, of course, is an ancient symbol for a master, for someone who has mastered the elements. Because a dragon flies, swims, breathes fire, and tramples the earth. So he conquers all of the elements of nature. He's a commander. He's a great force. So the dragon of wisdom is a Christ. Of course, Alberich makes himself appear as a great dragon because he's very full of himself, full of pride. This relates specifically to what you'll see happening with Alberich later on. But as a little preview, we can say this. Those who learn how to take the gold from the waters through the science of alchemy begin to walk a very treacherous road, because each little particle of energy that is taken through the process of transmutation, through alchemy, is energy that needs to be used. But it's our own individual will that decides how to use it. This isn't a mechanical process. It's not an automatic process. So in the story of this scene, Alberich uses his self-will, his selfish will, to build the Tarnhelm and the ring in order to sustain his pride and to fulfill his resentment. And we do that. But specifically, there are people who do that and awaken the consciousness. In other words, that eye of Odin, which was sunk into the waters, opens. That eye becomes awake, but in the depths. And then the Tarnhelm and the ring make themselves into this dragon, which is very pleased with itself and has powers over nature. And what is that but a sorcerer, a black magician? And this is what Alberich becomes in this moment. And why does he do it? Because of Loge. Not because Loge tells him to. Loge tempts him. Loge says, oh, you're a big shot now. Show me what you can do. Our own mind does that. That's Loge inside of us, who says, oh, now you've got some power. Flex it. Show me. Show others. Demonstrate your new self. And this is all, of course, deceptive. What the dragon, this kind of false dragon, the black magician, or us, for example, doesn't realize is that we're being tricked by our own mind. And Loge is just manipulating. So right now in our own station of life, in some form or another, we're doing this. We believe we are such and such a person with such and such virtues, and we believe we are self-sufficient. We have a self-will. But that's egotistical. We don't realize the source of our real power, which is God. And that's because our own selfish mind has us hypnotized. But that mind is being tempted by our own Loge, our own Mephistopheles. And we don't realize that Loge tempts us repeatedly and traps us. And this is all karma. Loge then, of course, in the story says, well, if you can make yourself into a dragon, do you have the power to make yourself into something very small? And so Alberich becomes a toad. And what is this? What is a toad? But false humility. To be small, to act humble, to act like you're a little thing, innocent, a little creature of nature. And of course, Loge traps him. So in this scene, we see a very direct symbol of some of the problems that we face as a psyche. And in the next scene, it gets a little more complicated.
Scene 4, an open space on a mountain summit. Wotan and Loge have returned to the higher regions of the mountains with their prisoner, Albrecht. Wotan demands that Albrecht pay them all his treasures as ransom before he can be freed. Using his magic ring, Albrecht summons the Nibelungs, which bring the treasures. The Nibelungs again disappear, and Albrecht demands to be set free. Wotan claims the Tarnhelm as well. Albrecht is furious, but tries to calm himself with the knowledge that Mime can forge a new magic helmet for him. But then Wotan demands the ring as well. Albrecht refuses to give up the ring, but Wotan forcefully tears it away from Albrecht's finger. The furious Albrecht now feels that his life has lost all meaning. Loge frees Albrecht. Crushed, Albrecht places a powerful curse on the ring. Whosoever possesses the ring will be its slave and is doomed. He will be envied and hated by others. Everyone will covet the ring. With these words, he leaves. Wotan ignores his words. Albrecht has disappeared, and the gods are generally quite satisfied with what Wotan has achieved. Fasolt and Fafnir return with Freya. Her presence quickly restores the youth of the gods. The giants return with Freya. The giants, especially Fasolt, will really miss Freya. In order to ease their loss, they demand enough gold to cover Freya completely and hide her from their sight. All the gold must be used in order to achieve this, and even the Tarnhelm is necessary in order to cover her hair. But Fasolt is still able to glimpse Freya's eye through a crack in the pile of gold. Fafnir rightfully points out that Wotan's ring is exactly the right size to fill the crevice. Wotan stubbornly refuses to let the ring go. The conjectured promise of power that is associated with the ring makes Wotan want to keep it for himself. The giants are not willing to accept this, and they start to leave with Freya. Just then, bathed in blue light, Erda, the earth goddess and mother, appears from the ground. Erda implores Wotan to give up the ring. She also declares that the end of the gods is near. Erda's message has made a powerful impression on Wotan, and he finally gives the ring to the giants. Freya is released, and the gods are reunited, apparently in happiness. Wotan is left with a new longing. He needs to see Erda again. The giants immediately start quarreling over the golden treasure and the ring. Fafnir kills his brother Fasolt and gets all the treasure. Seemingly, Albrecht's curse on the ring is already working. The power of the curse horrifies Wotan. The gods now intend to celebrate their apparent victory, and they prepare to enter Valhall for the first time. After the late events, however, the mood is not exactly too bright. To clear the air, Donner calls forth a storm. Lightning and thunder appears on his demand. As the heavens clear, a rainbow forms a bridge for the gods to enter Valhall. Wotan is uncertain with regard to what the future will bring. His hope is that the fortress will keep the gods safe and secure. Noting how the setting sun gilds the noble structure, Wotan tells Fricka their abode is called Valhalla. As the gods are walking over the rainbow bridge to Valhalla, Loge stays behind and remarks to himself that the gods are merely hastening to their own end. He contemplates the day that he can return back to his elemental form, fire, and burn everything. From the valley below, the Rhine maidens can be heard mourning their lost gold. The gods ignore the Rhine maidens and enter Valhalla.
This act, of course, is the end of this opera. At the beginning of this particular scene, Wotan and Loge have arrived back into the higher realms, bringing Albrecht. And Wotan demands the gold. And of course, since Albrecht, the ego, has no choice, he calls his underlings to bring all the gold and give it to the gods. Wotan also claims the Tarnhelm and the Ring. And out of his fury, Albrecht, of course, has to agree, but with the agreement, he curses the Ring. To fully explain this symbol, you would have to study and meditate on what happened with the evolution of this race, of this humanity. It's partly symbolized in this opera, how when the soul, or the cathedral of the soul, the Temple of Solomon, is being constructed in the superior realms, this, of course, symbolizes how energy is descending through matter and forming each level or each layer that God needs in order to fully know himself. And these are related to our soul, to our inner bodies, to the soul, the mind, the heart, the vital body, and the physical body, these different levels. And the construction of these levels of our development happened through the progression of past ages of races in our history, the polar, Hyperborean, Lemurian, and Atlantean ages. But as we know from the book of Genesis, when Eve, tempted by desire, her own lust, her own mind, eats the fruit, it's the same as Albrecht stealing the gold. And what's represented here is both Albrecht and Eve are symbolizing different views of the same psychological core related to the primeval levels of our own mind, from these past times, these past ages. And through the process of that temptation and those struggles, our own inner psychology, our own mind, or these levels of the soul, developed through steps. The problem is, there was a mistake. There were some errors made by the gods themselves in the development or the guidance of this race, of this humanity. There was a small miscalculation. And the end result was that when Wotan comes to take the gold, there is a curse. In other words, when the gods came to remove a certain section, a certain piece of the physiology of humanity in past times, a shadow remained. A little miscalculation was there. A curse. Of course, the curse that Albrecht places is that whoever uses the ring, whoever has this power, is doomed. And you might ask, why is all of this necessary? Why does all this happen? If God is God, why are there curses? Why is there suffering? Why are these problems there? It's the nature of understanding. It's the nature of comprehension. The problems come because of karma, which build upon previous karmas. The self-knowledge of God is the comprehension of perfect action, intuitive action. And there are subtleties in the mind, even in the levels of gods, that can produce little aberrations, little imperfections. And that's why manifestation is there. If those imperfections were not there, nothing would be manifest. So manifestation occurs in order for each level, each creature in each level, to comprehend the errors of that level and to change them, to gradually improve. Unfortunately, we are caught in the wheels of this big machine. And this curse is both self-generated and a product of karma, a product of our particular cosmic scenario. So you have to comprehend the curse of Albrecht as a curse on this humanity, but due to complicated reasons. Both our own desire, our own lust, our own craving for power, but also some little miscalculations by the gods. For example, how is it that Albrecht was able to create these things? It was necessary. In the same way that we as a humanity need to develop reasoning, to develop the heart, in order for us to develop these capacities, we need the powers of God. In other words, perception, memory, reasoning. And with those powers of consciousness, we're able to elaborate and grow spiritually. But unfortunately, that shadow of the ego corrupts the process and introduces a problem. Now, the opera moves into a new level here. When the gods take from Albrecht the gold and the ring, they retrieve also the goddess of love, who is the source of their own power, love. And in acquiring her back, they deliver to the giants the gold and the ring. And the giants represent these past physical races, these humanities, the Lemurians and Atlanteans. But they also symbolize parts of our mind related to Cain and Abel. In the Bible, you'll remember that Cain and Abel were the children of Adam and Eve. And Cain and Abel both were devoted to making sacrifices to God, in the same way that the giants are. The giants are making exchanges with the gods, with Wotan. And in any exchange, there's always mutual benefit. When we perform a ritual or we perform a meditation practice, we're performing an exchange with our own God. Meditation is a way that we provide elements for the growth of our consciousness, which helps our own inner being, our own God, to develop his own understanding. It also helps us. There's an exchange. The same happens with prayer. The same happens with transmutation. There's always an exchange of energy. Well, this is what's happening with the giants. They're making an exchange. They're building, by passing through evolution, these past ages, these past races, were going through the process of elaborating psychological structures. And these are particularly related to our mind and heart. When Cain and Abel in the Bible are making their sacrifices, there's a difference between them. Cain is a hunter. Cain is making a sort of inferior sacrifice. And Abel's sacrifice is greater. He's a shepherd. He gathers sheep. Cain gathers fruit and herbs and nuts and things like that. So God prefers Abel's sacrifice, and out of jealousy, Cain kills him. We see in the opera that we're studying that these two brothers are jealous of each other. But there's a little difference. Here in the opera, it's Fasolt. Isn't it Fasolt that is in love with Freya? So these two brothers begin to fight over the gold. And the basis of the argument is that the one brother, Fasolt, feels like he gave up more. He gave up more of a sacrifice because he had to give up Freya, the goddess, because he wanted her. So the other brother says, well, then I deserve more of the treasure because I had to give up and deal with you and your stuff this whole time, so I'm going to take more for myself. And the first brother feels like he deserves more of the treasure because he had to give up the goddess. So, of course, they fight. And what happens? Cain kills Abel. Fasolt dies. In this moment, what we're seeing is, of course, some historical conflicts related to these races. We're also seeing how our own mind, Fafnir, kills the soul because of desire. So there are levels. In the first part, we see Albrecht, who's a more primordial aspect of our psyche, who steals the gold. The gods take it back. But then the giants who are elaborating the soul, which are the mind and soul of us, the giants are one with the castle. They are part of that. They built it. They have jealousy. That means they still have animal nature. They are giants. They have big stature. They have strength. Our own mind and heart have strength, but not the intelligence of the gods. We still have jealousy and pride. And so they fight. And Fafnir kills Fasolt. Fafnir then would represent the mind. Fasolt represents the soul. Abel. And they leave. Now the gods, after all of this, are left disheartened. And this is symbolized by the sky being oppressive and overcast. So Donner steps up. Donner, as I mentioned, carries a hammer or an axe. And this is a symbol of willpower. So Donner would be related to the Holy Spirit, to Bina on the Tree of Life. And he is the god of lightning and storms, like Indra from the Hindus. So he conjures a big storm, which comes and clears the atmosphere. And as a result of that, his brother Fro follows suit and calls forth rain. Fro is a symbol of the cosmic Christ. He's the god of light. And the result of the activity of these gods is a rainbow. In the Bible, the rainbow is a symbol of God's promise after the flood of Noah. And the flood of Noah is closely related to this story as well. The flood came in order to destroy all the impure human beings, which were the Atlanteans. Which was who? It was the giants who just died. So there was a flood. In other words, the great destruction came, and then the rainbow comes. Same as in the Bible. You have it here in this opera. You have it in the Nordic mythology. Of course, the rainbow is the light that is expressing from this trinity of Wotan, Fro, and Donner. And that ray, the cosmic Christ, is a light. And what else is that light in the opera? But the bridge itself for the gods to cross over into their celestial abode, into the soul. So this rainbow is itself the path. And the path is a path of light. Now, how are you going to walk on light? How are you going to walk on a path made of light? Especially if your own darkness does not comprehend it. You have to become one with that light. So we see then at the end of this opera a beautiful symbol of what's to come. The gods begin to enter into Valhalla. The name Valhalla means the hall of the warrior. And in the mythology, we know that this hall is represented as the place where all the dead heroes go. Meaning that a great hero, only a great hero, not just anyone, but a great warrior, when that warrior dies, they cross the rainbow bridge and enter into the domain of the gods. And what else is that but a symbol of mystical death? That our own ego, Albrecht, and related to the giants as well, has to die. But that death only comes in battle, in the war to redeem the soul. And that is what all the rest of the three operas are about, which we'll enter into in the preceding, in the next lectures. Any questions? I think that Wotan falling asleep there, my impression is it has levels of meaning. What comes to my mind is Vishnu, Brahma, where that god in the Hindu myth falls asleep and dreams, and the dream is life, is manifestation itself. But it may well be related to Adam falling asleep too. Because in a sense, Wotan or Odin is a celestial Adam. So it could be. Any other questions?
Well, mm-hmm. Jesus stated that Brahma sleeps mm-hmm. and Brahma needs to awake.
Right. So, the Hindu myth states that Brahma sleeps, but Brahma needs to awaken. And that, of course, is the path. The whole process of the warrior on the path is the process of the full development of the human being. And that full development is the awakening of God, which is the Hindus call self-realization.
You say that Logi is part of God, just like the other gods, but he kind of knows what's going to happen, he's just making it all come together. Is that like kind of his role of sending certain events happening?
Yeah, Logi, you reminded me also that I missed part of the last act related to the goddess of the earth. But yeah, Loge is different from the other gods. He seems to operate according to different rules and has a very different psychology. And there's a reason for that. He is fire. He is the elemental intelligence or the fundamental wisdom of Christ, which is fire, which is light, which is, of course, the bridge itself. So he's a kind of symbol that's beyond selfhood, beyond the kind of individuality that a god has, like Wotan, or like Fricka or Freya. In other words, he is the light, he is the fire, but he's trapped because of these complications. So this is why the Bible says, O son of the morning, how you have fallen. Because that light has become trapped in the karma, in the problems, which have unfolded, of course, through this process. And in that sense, he has a very dualistic and very unpredictable nature. His goal, what's curious about Loge and the other representations of him, like Mephistopheles, he always seems to try to conquer his opponent. But in reality, he wants to lose. And you see that very well in the story of Job in the Bible, which is the best story in the Bible related to Lucifer, where you see how Lucifer is actually doing God's will by going to Job and basically destroying his life to test him. And that's Loge's job. Loge serves Wotan. But the way he does it seems very contradictory to our own self-idea. Our own idea, the way we have the self-nature, is we want things to be perfect and beautiful, like that. But Loge knows better, because he sees the roots of things, he sees the causes, he knows the karma.
Someone that's like a black magician only sees one side of that, and I think, it's trying to help him by a different way.
Yeah, he appears like a black magician, it's true. And we think of him that way. But a black magician, like you say, only sees one side because he only sees through his desire. Loge is trapped in that, but because his root intelligence is from the Christ, he can see beyond that. So he is a very subtle force for our intellect to capture. And when you will really comprehend him is when you have experiences with him in yourself. Through your own practice, through your own efforts. When you interact with your own inner Lucifer, your own inner Loge, then you'll get it. You realize he's both your worst enemy and your best friend. Just like in the great opera Mephistopheles. You see that, beautiful. Or in the story by Goethe. That Loge, or Lucifer, is the great tempter. But without temptation, there's no way to conquer. Without fire, there can be no light. So he's that God of fire that provides the capacity to awaken the light. It's a very challenging thing to grasp. You have a question?
What is the meaning of Freya being covered with the gold?
Well, of course, Freya is the goddess of love. And when the giants demand their payment, this is symbolic of that level of our own psyche, which is demanding gifts and powers, benefits from God, which, in a sense, was deserved. But the problem is that the giants became identified with the gold. And that identification with spiritual powers is exactly what brought the Atlanteans to their ruin. Because they developed this lust for more spiritual power. In other words, through black magic. There was a portion, a small aspect of that civilization that still retained the vision of the goddess, right, which is Freya. But they, too, in turn, were tempted by the mind. So then the mind demanded more and more and more, and eventually brought about their own destruction. So that identification with powers, with spiritual benefits, can actually create your own doom. This is part of why in Gnosis we emphasize the importance of developing serenity, to learn how to accept things as they are, to not cultivate desire in any form, whether it's physical, whether it's spiritual, whether it's emotional. Because desire doesn't work merely through physical desire. Desire works through the heart. Desire works through the mind. And it can veil itself as spiritual ambition, or spiritual, like the ambition to advance on the path. You know, that Gnostic students and Gnostic followers can become very entranced with that. This idea, like, if I get a spouse and if I learn this teaching, then I can really advance spiritually. The longing is naturally there in the soul because God is the one pushing that. But that longing can easily be corrupt by our own desire. And then we become like those giants, jealous and fighting. I missed one symbol. At the end of the opera, Wotan is giving a warning. When he wants to keep the ring, the earth goddess rises up. She's a very mysterious figure in this opera. If you watch the opera, you'll see that. She just sort of appears, gives her warnings, and goes away. And the result is that Wotan is left really wanting to know more from her. And for me, this is a really beautiful symbol, a beautiful story of how even our own being is searching for knowledge, has longing. These very elevated aspects of our own soul also need and are searching. That Earth Mother is representative of the primordial chaos, the Prakriti, that womb, which is reflected in the waters of the Rhine. And her specific power is that she is, that's not in the opera, but if you study the mythology, she is always informed by her three daughters, who are, of course, the Rhine maidens. They are past, present, and future. So the earth goddess always knows what has happened, what is happening, and what will happen. And sometimes she intervenes. And in this case, she does. And she does this for the benefit of Wotan. Now, what's really interesting also about this symbol is here we have a representation of Keter, the first manifestation. And yet he does not know her. Keter, the father, does not know this goddess. And this is representative of how he needs knowledge. He needs to know more. And that's really what the whole operatic theme is throughout, is the necessity for our own inner God to develop, to gain knowledge. So, any other questions? Yeah?
Do some of the lyrics that aren't real words like heda and hedo have any meaning?
Well, I imagine that if you were to meditate and utilize those phrases, you would probably find out. Next question.
In another lecture, it was mentioned that the fortress represents the mind blocking our understanding of the superior worlds. Can you elaborate upon this?
Of course. When we talk about the mind here, this term has, like most terms, many levels. The term mind is not limited to our brain. In some cases, you can say that mind and consciousness are interchangeable. And certainly, if you study Buddhism, that's how they use the word. They use the word mind instead of consciousness. So sometimes in the course of these lectures, that's the sense that we're using. And in other cases, we're describing, let's say specifically, Netzach on the Tree of Life, which is related to our mental body. Or that structure in our psyche which is able to process thought. But that is not mind by itself. Really, the term mind is related to manas, which is Tiferet. And mind also relates to Gebura, because in Sanskrit, buddhi means intellect. So what I'm pointing out to you here is that these three spheres, Gebura, Tiferet, and Netzach, are all directly related to mind. So in that sense, we can say mind is this structure on the tree which acts as an intermediary between God and us. Mind is very deep and very high at the same time. There are levels. That's part of the reason we study the Tree of Life. Because Atman, in his way, in his level, has a kind of mind. So does God. So does the Christ. It's a mind of a certain level. In what you're referring to as the castle becoming an obstacle, this is how our own reasoning, our own mind, our own soul, can become an obstacle for us when we don't control it. Okay, intellect. Well, intellect is different. Mind would be a little more abstract. Mind is more like a mirror. Mind reflects. But it is not the image. And in itself, it's empty. The mirror itself is nothing. It's just a surface. And our own soul is similar. The soul that we have now and the soul that we need to develop is simply a mirror of a certain level. The way we are now, we have an essence. We have a spark of consciousness. And its power of reflection is very small. This is why when you close your eyes, you see darkness. This is why when you dream, you're in chaos. You're not awake. You're asleep. Because that mind is very small. It has a narrow band of light that it can reflect. When you create the soul, you create a bigger surface. When you awaken consciousness, the mirror becomes polished. When the soul elevates and the level of being raises, the mirror is getting bigger, clearer, more perfected. The perfection of that mirror is the return into the absolute, in which that mirror is perfect, without any dust, and the dust would be the ego. Intellect is the capacity to discriminate between yes and no. We need that tool in order to comprehend the reflection of the imagery. Do you grasp that? Without intellect, without reasoning, How could you comprehend fully? You could comprehend to a level, like an animal can comprehend sensation or images up to a point, emotionally, instinctively, but not with reasoning, not through comparing, not through analyzing information, and the intellect provides that. That capacity to compare images can become an obstacle when that capacity is not under the guidance of Wotan, or God, our own being. And really, that capacity, that guidance, comes through buddhi, gebra, which is called intellect. That's the meaning of that term. But it doesn't mean intellect in the way we think of it. It's a superior, very abstract form of mind. Right. Another term for that is Sophia, from Pisces Sophia. And that is a capacity that we have related to the pineal gland. This is a good moment to point out that the power of the Tarnhelm is the power of the pineal gland. But it's how the forces of God are harnessed by will. And you'll discover more about that in the next opera. Any other questions? No? Okay. Thank you very much. Sorry we went so long. And I look forward to the next one.
To learn more about what you learned in this lecture, we invite you to explore the books published by Glorian Publishing, available from booksellers worldwide. You may also be interested in online courses or upcoming retreats, all of which you can learn about at GnosticTeachings.org. All of this has been made possible by the financial support of listeners like you. Will you help others to benefit from this knowledge? Most spiritual schools recommend a donation of $10 to $20 per lecture. Every donation helps. Make a donation now at GnosticTeachings.org. Thank you. May all beings be happy.